I'm going to talk a little bit about how today goes from here, how we proceed through joy. Joy, I think, is a little more complicated than people think, although we just managed to finish to bring a whole pile of it into the room. When we were thinking about the day of joy, we realized research is much better at doing misery and conflict. It's quite tricky to find research and investigation into joy. And we were really, I was scratching my head a bit about where we went. And then Eimear McGlinchey, who will be up here shortly, rang me up and said, I've got an idea. What if we start to look at joy through the lens of the lives of people with Down syndrome? And what if we got them to tell us about joy? And so that's where this next session starts. So the next session will run for about 2 hours-ish. There is a cast of thousands. There will be people often on stage. We want your love and affection and generosity for everybody that's up here. After that, as we did yesterday, we're going to disappear into the living labs. We're going to invite you to take a deep dive into visual arts or dance upstairs or neuroscience in here. Or you get a chance to hear Mike and see Aileen and see Kathy play at lunchtime. And then in the afternoon, we step into a slightly different way of looking at joy. We look at sustaining joy. How might you keep it going? Can you keep it going? And what are the organization and structural and educational things you need to do? And if that sounds a little bit dull, believe me, it won't be. And then we round up this afternoon with Chris Bailey, who you heard this morning, with the Provost of Trinity College and with Tanya Bonotti from Creative Ireland, talking really about joy into the future. So that feels like a good place to move into the next session. We good? Yeah. Can I welcome with huge pleasure Mayin to the stage?
This is something. Okay, so I would like to welcome you all here today to the celebration of brain health in people with Down syndrome as part of Creative Brain Week. I am Maylin Yap. In today's session is called Complex Joy. Joy comes from many different special moments in life. For me, when I think about joy, I think about time spent with my family. I also think of my happy places. My happy place is work, having a reason to get up in the mornings. I work in CPL as a senior HO assistant and in Trinity Centre for Aging and Intellectual Disability, and I am very passionate about the work that I do in both places. My other happy place is my holiday house in Wexford. Another part of joy for me is my dog, Murphy. He brings a lot of joy in my life. I go for walks with my mum and Murphy. My friendships are also really important to me and bring me a lot of joy. So, as you can see, I have a lot of joy in my life. I really love life. Now, take a moment to think about your own happy place and what brings you joy. It's important for all of us to remember this sometimes. I have a lot of things to look forward to have my own home, to be like any other person, paying bills, having my own home, going to work, going to social gatherings, just to name a few. But there are some things that are complex. When I think about the future, there are things that I want to do, but I know that dementia might play a part in my life too. As someone with Down syndrome, I have I know that there is a risk for Alzheimer's disease, and that's a genetic risk. But I'm doing my part to stay engaged, fit, and healthy. I like to inform myself about what's going on and staying up to date. Because of my work in Trinity, I pay more attention to information about getting older. I learn about what it's like to age. Before this, I didn't really understand as much about aging and all the things that go along with getting older. I've learned things about resources, about services, and about so many different things that have to happen to help to age well, age with pride. And people with Down syndrome have to be included in this too. And so today, I am so excited to hear the other speakers, to learn from them and be inspired by them. I hope you all listen, learn, and get inspired too. I'll now hand you over to my colleague, Eimear McGlinchey, who will go through what we have in store for you today and talk about some of the research from Ireland. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Maylin, for opening the day with such an incredible speech. Thank you so much. Morning, everyone. My name is Eimear McGlinchey. I'm an assistant professor in intellectual disability here in Trinity and a Global Atlantic Fellow at GBHI. We're here today to talk about dementia, brain health, and people with Down syndrome. And we're talking about that today because there is a genetic link between Down syndrome and Alzheimer's disease, as Maylin mentioned, and as some of our speakers will talk about today. I just want to give a little bit of history and context on that. People with Down syndrome have contributed so much to what we know now about Alzheimer's disease. In 1984, Glenner and Wong made this groundbreaking discovery of amyloid beta, which has really driven a lot of the research on Alzheimer's disease since then. And that research was done with people with Down syndrome. So people with Down syndrome have already contributed so much and are inextricably linked to the history of Alzheimer's disease. And now we really have to make sure that they're included in the future in terms of research, in terms of treatments, and opportunities to be available, the opportunities to be involved in research and to be involved in treatments when they come available. The research we're doing in Trinity spans the continuum of brain health. So we're looking at prevention, brain health promotion, assessment, diagnosis, and also post-diagnostic support. And I just want to introduce our amazing speakers today and talk a little bit about how their talks link in with the research that we're doing here in Ireland. There's a project I'm running called Prevent Dementia DS, which is a project examining early biomarkers of Alzheimer's disease in people with Down syndrome. And this is with pilot funding from GBHI. So this project is including younger people with Down syndrome without dementia to understand about the organization of brain networks in the brain and how these relate to blood markers that we know are related to Alzheimer's disease and also cognitive markers. And some of this data is shared with partners around Europe in the Horizon 21 European Down Syndrome Consortium. And one of those collaborators is Dr. Juan Fortea, who will be speaking today on his research in Barcelona, where Juan runs the largest biomarker program for people with Down syndrome in the world. Participants from this project, Prevent Dementia DS in Ireland, will also have the opportunity to be involved in a global initiative project to make sure that people with Down syndrome will be included in clinical trials. So this project is called Track DS, or Trial Ready Cohort DS. And Professor Sean Kennelly is leading that project in Ireland, and he's going to speak today about the future of research and where treatment will be heading for people with Down syndrome. We also have a number of different brain health promotion initiatives, and one of those is an online social group called Brain Buzzers. And some of our members of Brain Buzzers are here today and are going to talk about what we do in the club, and there'll be some surprises along the way as well. We are so happy to have a special guest, McCarron, who is an honorary brain buzzer today, who's going to lead us in a song. And you don't know it yet, but you're also all going to be involved in this. So please do sing along, get up on stage as well if you can. One of the most important developments in Ireland in dementia and intellectual disability was the development of the National Intellectual Disability Memory Service in 2020. This service provides specialist assessment, diagnosis, and post-diagnostic support for dementia for people with an intellectual disability. And this addresses a real inequity that was there in Ireland before this service was developed, where people with an intellectual disability, if they weren't part of a service that provided memory support, really there wasn't anywhere to go. And this service is a real tangible culmination of decades of work by Professor Mary McCarron in the area of dementia in people with Down syndrome. And Mary's going to talk today a reflection on her work and the changes that she's seen, and also on joy. You'll see a number of themes recurring throughout the day today. So one of inclusion is going to come up a number of times. The importance of inclusion of people with Down syndrome in research and in other opportunities that we know will be good for brain health. We're also looking at hope and looking forward, looking into the future, at where research is going and where we see treatment for dementia going for people with Down syndrome. The relationship is complex. And as we're talking today about joy, you may be thinking, where is the association between Alzheimer's disease and joy? But there is joy in how far we've come. We've come a long way from 1929, when the life expectancy for people with Down syndrome was 12 years of age. We've come a long way in terms of Alzheimer's disease research. And as we're looking into the future, there is great hope. Our first speaker today, Fintan Bray, is going to talk about some of these themes. He's going to talk about his own experience and his own journey, and his experience of being part of the research project Prevent Dementia DS. So could I please welcome Fintan Bray.
Well, firstly, before I say my speech, wow. Can't believe I am here at a Brain Week. What an incredible experience here in Trinity College. Now we're here to my speech. Hi, my name is Fintan Bray, and I am the first person with Down syndrome in Ireland, and possibly the world, to be elected to a senior position in a political party. I am very proud of the fact that I've made history, and I'm planning on being the voice for everyone with disabilities, especially in terms of important issues, getting access to education and paid employment. We know that education and employment are things that are important for your brain health. I want to make sure that people with disabilities, and particularly people with Down syndrome, are given opportunities to do things that will keep their brain healthy when we get older. Now I have a voice in politics. I want to make a difference and use this role for the change to help others. So I'll just turn the page here. When I was growing up, I had to work hard to walk, to talk, to read, to write. I was 12 before I could ride a bicycle. My parents had to fight to make sure I could go to our local national school, where my brothers and sisters went. Over the years, I attended speech therapy to approve publications and to get support reading and writing. When I finished school, I went to look for a job and I got some work experience. I eventually got an interview at Kana Brenny House in Kells after Down syndrome honor put me through. I have been working there for 5 years now and I love it. Living your life to the fullest is what I'm all about. I try to do things that will keep me healthy. We know that exercise is really important for your health and your brain health. I spent my time on it and I got my first ever bronze medal in the World Championships in Canada in 2018. To get that, I had to work hard and train. But all the work paid off. But last year, I qualified again for the Europeans. I picked up artistic swimming. And now I'm going to Italy again for the September, this September. Life as a young, independent man is busy. I enjoy contact with my friends on social media. Thanks to my third level skills, I can cook, clean, and even I can bake. But most important, be independent. Be who I am today, which I am glad who I am today. I have a good social life, thanks to my family who dropped me and picked me up when I needed a lift. I like hanging out with my female friends and dance with them. All of these things are important for me to keep my brain healthy. Now I want to lose my position on a disability network to help other people with disabilities to get opportunities to do things that keep their brain healthy. Today, I am speaking at Equitative Brain Week, but in the future, I want to help people with disabilities also have the opportunity to speak. The other thing that are really important is that people with disabilities included in research on brain health. Last year, I took part in research that Eimear is doing to find out more about the brain. It was really good experience to take part in research. I did a blood test and an MRI scan, and Eimear came to my house to ask questions. I do some tests. When she comes to my house, we have tea and scones. But not too much. Which also helps. Eimear's research helped me to learn more. I never saw a picture of my brain before. It was really cool. Being there to help Eimear for her research was great. I was glad to be a part of it. Being a part of something to help to find out more about the brain. And that might help people in the future. I want to thank a few people, my family, who have worked very hard to be there for me. To get to this stage, I could have achieved this without the support of my parents, Eamon and Mary. And my brothers and sister, Kenneth, Fikra and Katrina. Just to let people to know, Fikra used to go to college here in Trinity College. They've always supported me through everything, and I want to seriously thank them all they have done. I would like to seriously thank you to Eimear for finding me here today and wishing her the very best in the future. This is a face that I always lose to me, and this is always in the bottom of my heart. This is me, my voice, my ability, and I keep on going to live my life to the fullest. But there's more. Before I introduce the next person, on the 21st of March, I am celebrating World Down Syndrome Day. To celebrate that moment, I'm going to Dancing with the Stars Dance Floor Studio this Saturday, which I am really looking forward to. Guys, before I leave, I will now introduce Dr. Juan Fortea.
Thank you. It's great to be here. It's an honor, and I want to thank Professor McCarron and McGlinchey for the invitation to be here today. And actually, when they invited me and they told me about the topic of today, I was surprised. It's not easy to be invited to give a talk on Alzheimer's and Down syndrome, and that the topic of the day is joy. It's complicated. But I have to admit that the more I thought, I realized that I've been giving these talks for over 12 years when we started working in this association between Down syndrome and Alzheimer's. At the beginning, it was really complex. It was very difficult because we were the harbingers of bad news, really bad news. It was an underappreciated association between Alzheimer's and Down syndrome, and it wasn't happy news. It was surprised for the audience, even specialists in Down syndrome, and it was complicated. And I think that over the years, we've grown confident, and I hope I convince you that we've gone a long way. We've advanced a lot in our understanding of the pathophysiology of Alzheimer's in Down syndrome. And now we are at a turn point, at a revolution in the AD field in general, and in particular for Down syndrome. And yeah, I thought that there were very, very valid reasons for hope. And today we've heard about sustained hope. And I think that this is the first time I titled a talk in such a way. And I truly believe it. And I will try to sustain this joy. I will try to always, from our own, keep this positive view about the future, because I truly believe there are reasons to hope. I've even said expect a future without dementia in people with Down syndrome. So these are my disclosures. And I've divided the talk into three parts. The first is not good news. The first is about the association between Alzheimer's and Down syndrome. It's really is the main comorbidity, is the main cause of death. And it truly reflects how important it is that we work and we fight against Alzheimer's. The second is why. So I'll give a few bullet points on the association, on why this genetic association between Down syndrome and Alzheimer's disease. And lastly, I will talk about how I believe we might defeat Alzheimer's in this population. And this comes through research. There's no other way we are going to beat Alzheimer's without research, without engaging them in clinical trials. So, first of all, very good news. The very good news is that we've come already a long way. This is the life expectancy. This is a paper that has some years already. It's from Australian data. And as you can see in the arrow, I don't have a pointing, do I? So in the dotted lines is the life expectancy in the general population. And in the 20th century, we've come from 60 to 80 years. But look what happened in the life expectancy with Down syndrome. It's amazing. It's an exponential increase, especially after the 60s with the advent of cardiac surgery. However, this is a bit misleading because you would expect from seeing this graph that in 20 years, this 20-year gap in life expectancy between people with Down syndrome and the general population would be over. Just follow the line. And this will not be the case if we don't find a cure for Alzheimer's, and I'll show you why. And the other consequence of this increase in life expectancy is that, contrary to what many people think, the Down syndrome population is a growing population. We've achieved a steady state in the number of births, and I think that's reflected in the bottom part of the right panel, so the blue and the orange. You can see that is more or less constant, the number of children with Down syndrome that are born in the US. But because they live longer, the other strata, the other age bands, are increasing dramatically. So it's like more than quadruple the number of people with Down syndrome now living in the US than there were 60 years ago. And that's way higher than the growth of the US population in those years. So it's a growing population. It's not a declining population. So why do people with Down syndrome live longer? And that's because we take better healthcare. People with Down syndrome now, we've seen it before, it's in the fantastic talks that preceded mine, that the horizon for people with Down syndrome now is completely different. And now we are able to treat many of the comorbidities associated with the syndrome. And here I want to emphasize something that's very simple but very important. Vision and hearing problems, they are highly associated with Down syndrome. And they decrease the quality of life significantly. They are even associated with dementia. So this taking care of these things is very important. And now we have very good guidelines on how to take care of these comorbidities in people with Down syndrome. And I refer to this paper in JAMA published two years ago on how we should treat and diagnose these comorbidities. But I was saying that this might lead us to a very over-optimistic view on the life expectancy in this population. And that's because we focus on the median age at the age of onset. And I was very puzzled with this article, because you can see, when you look at the median, we have this impression of the increase in the survival in people with Down syndrome. But look what happened to the 95th percentile, those that were living longer. It seemed as if those that were living longer were not catching up. They were not living beyond the age that was expected in the 70s in this article. So, and when you look at the actual estimates for the population with Down syndrome and compare them with the general population, as I say, we still have a 20 to 25 year difference in the life expectancy. And the question that we wanted to address, and I'll show you a few slides of a recent paper that we published, is will life expectancy ever be equal in the general population and Down syndrome? And this is the work I was referring to, and this I want to emphasize the huge amount of work that Florencia Ulita, the first author of this paper, put in here. It was a meta-analysis and a very original paper, I believe. And this, spoiler alert, the two messages that I will convey is that AD is limiting this life expectancy and is the main cause of death, and something that is crucial for DS as a model for Alzheimer's disease is that it has near full penetrance and a predictable age at symptom onset. These two ideas are, in my opinion, critical. So we first did a meta-analysis on all the papers published in the literature in the last 30 years, Europe, US, and other continents too. And as you can see, there were no harmonization whatsoever in the diagnostic methodology and how people that just diagnosed dementia the best they could. But please see that the age at dementia diagnosis was very conserved across all the studies in this meta-analysis. And the median age at dementia diagnosis is 53.8. The mean age at death when you have Alzheimer's was 58. There were fewer studies. And the disease duration from dementia diagnosis to death was 4.6 years. This is shorter than the survival in the general population. We can speculate on what that is, but it's one of the few differences that we're finding between DSAD, the Down syndrome-associated Alzheimer's disease, and Alzheimer's disease in the general population. But now, bear with me, because we did something that I think was original, or at least we hadn't seen it before, and we said, okay, now let's test this idea that AD is truly limiting the life expectancy in people with Down syndrome. So if we know when people are supposed to develop Alzheimer's, 53.8, and the disease duration, 46.8, you have the formula down there, but basically the concept is very simple, is that people should be dying from Alzheimer's at around 59.8 years, and that's the variability along this disease onset. So that's taking from the meta-analysis on all the cases, real-world cases in the world, that had been reported with dementia. So that's people only dying from Alzheimer's. So the experiment here is you can only die from Alzheimer's. So that's the distribution, the age at death for that distribution. And so now what we're going to do is plot that distribution to the right, upper right there, and we're going to confront that from the real-world mortality data from the CDC, so from the Centers of Disease Control in the US. That's over 70,000 deaths in people with Down syndrome in the last decades. And I hope you see this idea. Again, look first at the median, that's the blue line. So this optimistic view that we're increasing the life expectancy, although now we are capturing a slight plateau. Look at the higher percentiles and the lower percentiles. And I hope you see that the higher percentiles are just below, are finding an asymptote, a ceiling, just below the theoretical age imposed by Alzheimer's disease. And this is, to me, very striking, because we did some sex and stratified the analysis by sex and by race. So sex is easier to explain, it's in the bottom panel, no difference, essentially. Very subtle differences. No, not real differences between male and female. But look what happens with race. So there is a structural racism still in the US, and it's not the same being born with being black or white in the US still. And I hope you see the huge gap for every percentile in life expectancy. But what's much interesting, it's very, very interesting, is to see where the gap is in the 70s and where the gap is now. So in the 70s, people were dying from cardiac cardiogenic problems. There was no treatment at that point for that. So there was no difference in the lower percentiles, those people that died early from cardiac disease. It didn't matter if you were white or black, you just died. And those that did not have cardiac problems, then all the inequalities in life exerted their toll, and there was a gap in the higher percentiles. That's in the left part of the figure. But now it's the opposite. Now those higher percentiles are now being capped by Alzheimer's disease. There is no treatment for that. So it's really sad to say that it's Alzheimer's that made us equal. But in those lower percentiles, those that are dying from treatable causes of Alzheimer's disease, that's where we still find a difference. So there is a still huge difference between white and black people, but the percentiles where they exert their effect are different. These are the reported causes of death in the CDC data. And as you can see, this the decrease in the congenital cardiac problems and the huge increase in the dementia. But this is a huge underreporting of the true toll of Alzheimer's disease in this population. It's already the first cause of death, with over 30% of death certificates associated with Alzheimer's disease, but this is a huge underappreciation. And so I don't have time to dive into the left panel is some mathematical approach, some estimations about the deaths, and that means that we estimate that with the CDC data, the true toll of Alzheimer's disease was responsible for around 70% of the deaths. And that is what I reflect in the right panel. In blue is the actual reported frequency of Alzheimer's in this population. In gray is our imputation on that data of 70%. In red, I guess, is the percentage of deaths that were died from Alzheimer's in our cohort in Barcelona. And this is in complete agreement with a previous report from Andres Tridham in London that had a similar report. So there is a huge underreporting. So that's what we're facing. We're facing a disease that might be killing 70% of people with Down syndrome now. So this is how important this is. This is the gap in the life, the main reason for the gap in the life expectancy between people with Down syndrome and Alzheimer's disease. So this is how important a problem it is and how important it is that we tackle it. So why about this association? I will necessarily have to go very quick here. But first of all, the previous speakers have already alluded to this. There is a genetic association between Down syndrome and Alzheimer's disease. And one of the first persons to really establish that it has had a near full penetrance, it was Professor McCarron here in the audience. And in this wonderful paper that she published following a large cohort of individuals with Down syndrome, she realized that if you follow them long enough, their actual risk is in excess of 95%. So it is near full penetrance, the Alzheimer's. And why is that? Because in chromosome 21, there are around 400 genes. It's more complex, but basically, the association with Alzheimer's disease is an APP, an amyloid precursor protein gene dose story. If any one of you had three copies of APP, you would develop presenile Alzheimer's disease, 100%. And Down syndrome is mainly full trisomy of Alzheimer's disease. They have three copies. So this is sufficient to cause Alzheimer's. And it is also necessary. There are very few cases that have been published that have microdeletions in the chromosome. So they have Down syndrome, but they didn't have APP triplicated. They did not develop dementia. They did not develop the biomarker changes. And this is hugely important because it gives us, it's a natural experiment of causality and that it does not develop Alzheimer's. The other very, very important message of the aforementioned meta-analysis is the predictability, the variability of the predictability of this disease in Down syndrome. Because everyone treating people with Down syndrome has faced persons with Down syndrome that have developed Alzheimer's at 45 and seen people with Down syndrome at 60 without dementia. And this gives this idea of tremendous variability in disease onset. And it's completely different with the impression we have in autosomal dominant AD, in which we are struck that if your father or mother develops Alzheimer's at 48, because you have, for instance, the PAISA mutation in Colombia, the E288 mutation in presenilin 1, you are bound to have Alzheimer's around that age. And we just ignore the variability about the 48 years of age in that population. So what we did is we took all the studies that we had looked at the meta-analysis, we plotted the variability around symptom onset, or dementia diagnosis to be more exact, and that's the red dots. And we compared those to another meta-analysis in autosomal dominant AD by Ryman et al. In 2014 in neurology. And I hope you see that there are three different ways of looking at the variability in symptom onset. It's not very appealing, the slide, but that's the best way we could find of showing it. But I hope that it doesn't matter how you see it. The blue dots and the red dots behave exactly the same. They have the same variability around symptom onset. So I'm not denying the variability of Alzheimer's disease in Down syndrome. I'm just saying that it is the same as in autosomal dominant AD. So Alzheimer's disease is as predictable or as variable, you choose the adjective, as autosomal dominant Alzheimer's disease. And this is hugely important in modeling. And this is a commentary I wrote a few months ago on another article that's really nice. And this enables us to use concepts such as the estimated years to symptom onset. We can use an anchor, the biomarker studies and the clinical trials at this 53.8, which it's a good reasonable estimate of disease onset. And we can do pseudo-longitudinal studies, and I will show you some examples of what we can do. So, how is Alzheimer's? So Alzheimer's is overshadowed sometimes by the intellectual disability, and there is huge variability here. There is a lot of variability in the intellectual performance. So if I ask a person with Down syndrome to draw a clock, he or she might do this, and this might or might not be his or her basal functioning. But if I follow this person over time, you do not need to be a neurologist or a neuropsychologist to truly easily see that this person is experiencing from Alzheimer's disease-related cognitive decline. And you, if you stratify individuals with Down syndrome by the level of intellectual disability into mild, moderate, profound, and severe, basically mild and moderate, which is where you can assess the cognitive performance easily, you can see that we can track the age-associated cognitive decline in blue, mild, in yellow, moderate. We can track the decline, and you can easily see that those with mild intellectual disability, they always perform higher than those with moderate. And if you do that, you can truly track the AD-related cognitive decline along the AD continuum. In green, those asymptomatic, in yellow, those with prodromal AD, and in red, those with AD dementia. And achieving great, a very good diagnostic performance, which is what we, in medicine, we use these rock analysis curves with the AUCs, at least for dementia diagnosis, very high, meaning very good diagnostic capability for neuropsych evaluations. And this is another way to look at this ultra-high risk of Alzheimer's disease. So in the left panel is those that are asymptomatic. They don't have any symptoms. They are healthy. And they are stratified by ages. So in red are those that are over the age of 50, asymptomatic at baseline. So you can see that if we follow them just a few years, a very big proportion of them are developing Alzheimer's. And those that are even 45 to 50 is a very significant. So it's a very tight association between age and the risk of progression along the AD continuum, as you can see here. And this is some numbers. So this is an amazing risk. This is a very, very high risk of developing Alzheimer's in very short periods of time in certain age ranges. And certainly if you have prodromal AD on the right, you're bound to have dementia in a very, very short time. So how is Alzheimer's in Down syndrome? So this is very easy to convey. It is almost the same, if not equal, to Alzheimer's disease in the general population. Or let me rephrase this, DSAD, Down syndrome associated Alzheimer's disease, is Alzheimer's disease. There was some debate a few years ago. And Eimear alluded to the discovery of APP, the amyloid, and the importance that CAA in the cerebellum in a patient had in the 80s. We know from the 80s that the topography of the lesions and the were the same in sporadic AD and Down syndrome. So these are photographs for amyloid on the top, parenchymal amyloid plaques, CAA in the middle, and tangles of tau. You know that Alzheimer's is mainly a story of amyloid and tau. So this, I hope you see how similar the pathology looks at the microscope. It's not only amyloid and tau, there is inflammation and trafficking and endosomal abnormalities. And these endosomal abnormalities, Down syndrome has played a key role also in understanding the relationship with Alzheimer's. So again, Down syndrome is a model to study Alzheimer's disease. We're not just helping people with Down syndrome, but helping them is probably the best way. You have to help us. So let me put this example, because this is something that we do not reflect. So We do not know how many here will develop Alzheimer's, and less so when we will develop Alzheimer's. And we're a fairly high risk if we don't die of other causes of developing dementia ourselves. But we don't know who or when develops Alzheimer's. But in Down syndrome, by age 40, they will all have Alzheimer's pathology, and Mary and others taught us that almost all of them will develop symptoms and dementia. So theoretically, this is something that you have in common for autosomal dominant AD and Down syndrome, but there are things that you can only study in Down syndrome, and one of them is pathology, because people with autosomal dominant AD, they just don't die before Alzheimer's. So we just don't have brains to study the pathological changes along the lifespan in autosomal dominant AD. But people with Down syndrome do die from other causes in the different. And so we do have brains of people with Down syndrome that we can study to understand the pathophysiology of Alzheimer's disease. And this is, for instance, a graph that we constructed in a review paper in which we saw that actually amyloid pathology starts intraneuronally, not extracellularly, in teenagers and children with Down syndrome, as early as that. Then they go on to develop diffuse plaques, and then they build up the full-blown AD pathology with neuritic plaques and tangles by age 40. And that is way before you can detect that pathology with CSF or PET biomarkers. This is way before. So this also is teaching us a lesson, because we often equate a negative amyloid PET to no amyloid in the brain. That is not completely so. So how are the biomarker changes? So if we have similar pathology and a biomarker should tell us about the pathology, it should come as no surprise that they should have same biomarker changes. And this is what I'm going to show from now on in different examples. So this is a paper that we published in CSF. And you can see that they have 50% reductions in amyloid levels and twofold increases in phospho-tau. That's exactly the signature you would expect in someone with a sporadic AD. Again, same pathological changes, you should have same biomarker changes in this population. And here, let me stop un momento. This is amazing. I mean, this truly reflects how committed this population is to research if we enable them to do that, if we empower them to do that. In our cohort, we've evaluated over 1,000 people in the health plan, and almost 300 of them voluntarily participated in the research program and have undergone a lumbar puncture. So this is how committed people with Down syndrome are to research, because there were some questions a few years ago. Will they be willing to do that? Will the families and people with Down syndrome be willing to participate in research? I don't think they can say it louder. I think this speaks in itself, by itself. Of course, these CSF biomarkers, they have excellent diagnostic performance. So this is, again, this ROC analysis, the AE Suisse for the core biomarker changes in the your right. What was a game changer, and that's another revolution that we're living now in sporadic AD and Down syndrome, is the plasma biomarker. So this was the first paper to show that plasma NFL, in this case, neurofilament light chain, is a protein that had excellent diagnostic performance. So that's a game changer. That means that a blood test that costs 70 euros can accurately diagnose symptomatic AD in this population. We've gone on to do other studies. So phospho-tau is one of the most studied biomarkers in sporadic AD, and this was the first one to be published in Down syndrome, and in collaboration with the Swedish group. And as you will see, it has very, very similar results. So a very sharp increase along the AD continuum from asymptomatic to prodromal to AD dementia, and very, very similar AUCs to those found with neurofilament light, showing that neurofilament reflecting neurodegeneration in this population is equivalent to AD. How about imaging? So again, the best way I could say is I didn't tell you these were the photos or the images from people with Down syndrome. This would be identical to those you would expect in the general population. So it's the same atrophy pattern in your left. the same hypometabolic pattern and the same amyloid deposition. And whenever you find subtle differences, these have been described already in autosomal dominant AD, such as the early amyloid striatal uptake in people with Down syndrome. So again, similar, if not identical, to a sporadic AD. And here is just how amazed I am about the advances that we had, because five years ago, people were writing editorials on how, on why we should not be optimistic on the prospect of having plasma biomarkers for Alzheimer's disease. And now it's the opposite. We will have plasma biomarkers in routine clinical practice, I believe, in the next five years. So we've completely changed. It's a U-turn on the expectations on plasma biomarkers. But even tau, amyloid is extracellular. Amyloid is intraneuronal and in very low quantities. In the last 5 years, again, 5 years, not 50, we've been able to scan and see this tau buildup in the brain. So this is an example of, we're working with the PI2620, this is a second generation tau tracer, and this is an example of a negative tau uptake. So this is a brain that is darkish, it's bluish, no tau in that brain. What you are seeing is the off-target in the eyes and other structures, but no tau in the brain. And this is how a brain full of tau in a demented person, in a person living with dementia, with Down syndrome, looks like. And you can see the tau uptake in the brain, which is quite amazing. And actually, if you compare again the tau uptake on the left, which is the sporadic AD pattern of tau uptake, and you compare to our results, I hope you see that the striking similarities in the topography and the intensity in all the regions, it seems almost the same, I hope, that you're seeing. So it's the same tau uptake in this population. And the great advantage of genetic forms of dementia, of Alzheimer's disease, autosomal dominant and Down syndrome, is that we can study the natural history. I alluded to that in the pathological slide. And here, what we did in collaboration with the group in Cambridge, led by Sahid Saman, is to study the clinical and biomarker changes in adults with Down syndrome along the lifespan. And I will not enter in all the details of the biomarkers, but this is a selection of biomarkers, of 9 biomarkers, in which in the x-axis is the decades, so it's from 18 to 70. In blue, people euploid controls from the general population. In red, people with Down syndrome. And I hope you see that the curves deviate very, very, very early on. And differentiate people with Down syndrome and those from the general population. And that this sequence is very predictable and it starts over 20 years before symptom onset in this population. I won't enter. And again, prodromal AD diagnosis at age 50 in this study and dementia diagnosis at age 53.7. Remember that in the meta-analysis that actually we published later than this study was 53.8. So very, very consistent, the disease onset. That's the natural history you could expect of the clinical biomarker changes in this population. But what's striking is that if I plot every biomarker in the left in Down syndrome, Alzheimer's disease, and I compare it to the biomarker changes in autosomal dominant AD, I color code the biomarkers in ATN, which is the framework we are now using for amyloid tau neurodegeneration. I hope you see that the trajectories, the chronopathology of the disease are essentially the same in both conditions. It's not only the directionality and magnitude of the biomarker changes, it's also the timing of these changes that are equal in both forms of the disease. So again, idea of on the variability and predictability that we've already worked, which is essential. This is the reason why in the US alone they've invested hundreds of millions of dollars to fight and understand autosomal dominant AD. They have a much larger and bigger opportunity here in people with Down syndrome. And how we will defeat Alzheimer's in this population? through clinical trials. We can defeat Alzheimer's in this population. We truly can. And this is a groundbreaking study. This is that was published last December in the New England Journal of Medicine, so only 2 months ago. And this study is the first inequivocally positive trial against Alzheimer's disease. The clinical effects are still modest, with a reduction in the disease progression of 27%, but all the primary and secondary biomarkers endpoints of this trial were positive. It's the first time that a clinical trial is absolutely positive against Alzheimer's disease. I've already alluded to the blood biomarkers and the digital revolution. And again, only in DS, this is the best population in which to perform preventive studies against Alzheimer's disease, to move from symptomatic trials to preclinical, because they are bound to have Alzheimer's, because you will not have any other population at such elevated risk and with these numbers. So it's only in DS. You say, okay, we can do that in autosomal dominant AD, surely, but go find them. We have more people with Down syndrome in Barcelona than autosomal dominant mutation carriers in the DIAN, which is the largest worldwide network for autosomal dominant AD. There are more people with Down syndrome in London or in New York than there are in autosomal dominant mutation carriers. So the opportunity is very clear. The other reason to hope is that now AD research in Down syndrome is not the work of pioneers like Mary McCarron, Brian Lawler, that very in the 90s, they've already started working in this population, like, I don't know, Wayne Silverman, Ira Lott. Now we have networks of centers working together, harmonizing protocols, as Eimear said, in the Horizon 21 with Trinity and this network of centers in Europe and in the US, and ABC Consortium and the ACTC, which is the TrackDS that the sign is going to talk about after. So amyloid is this gene dose effect of amyloid. We can take amyloid from the brain. We've seen it with lecanemab. This is another antibody. And we're about to start next month or in 2 months, the first active vaccine, phase two. This is from AC Immune. And anti-amyloid therapies must be tested in Down syndrome and will start very, very, very soon. But we have to be careful. People with Down syndrome do have more amyloid angiopathy, and this is a work that Maria Carmona, who did her PhD, and Maria Carmona was an Atlantic fellow too, and a GVH fellow here at Trinity. And we know that people with Down syndrome, they have more amyloid angiopathy, and amyloid angiopathy is closely linked to the side effects of these therapies, ARIA, amyloid-related imaging abnormalities. And this is something that is worrying us, because it does happen, and this is the first case that we reported of CAA-related inflammation. Let me say that this cannot stop us, that not to perform research is a new form of discrimination. And whenever I see these photos of participants in our studies here in Barcelona, I think they are fully committed and we cannot truly let them down. And with that, I will finish by saying that AD is a genetic form of Alzheimer's disease with near full penetrance. That AD pathology and biomarker changes are similar, if not identical, to those described in sporadic AD and autosomal dominant AD, and that there is a sequence, a predictable sequence of clinical and biomarker changes in Down syndrome-associated Alzheimer's disease, as in autosomal dominant AD, but with orders of magnitude more subjects. And as such, it is the ideal population to perform preventing clinical trials and to develop biomarkers. And I'm truly convinced that AD might be easier to cure in DS than in the general population. And again, not to perform research is a form of discrimination. It's the only way we will improve their quality of life and their life expectancy. And with that, I would like to finish by thanking all the participants, all the fantastic team that we have in Barcelona, and all the funders. Thank you very much.
So We have time for a few questions. If you'd like to just put up your hand, we'll run around a little bit. And also, because we have people at the back of the room, if you'd like to, if you can move into the middle, it'd be great.
Juan, thanks so much. I think it's a brilliant story of hope over the last 30 years. My question really was around the variability you showed around the age of onset. I know the work that you're doing and Eimear and others and Mary are doing in terms of lifestyle intervention. So I just wonder, is there an opportunity to make that age of onset even more variable by the lifestyle type interventions that people have been talking about? You know, and I think that certainly in thinking the PREVENT study, the family study, the parent study, let's say of PREVENT Down syndrome, is that it does look like modifiable risk factors and lifestyle factors do seem to be able to affect pathology early on. So I'm just wondering, could the same operate in Down syndrome? And obviously, I think the huge potential for disease-modifying therapy is fantastic for Down syndrome. But I'm wondering about lifestyle factors. Can you, push that age of onset out?
So I'm going to give an answer that is less optimistic and is different from an answer I would have given 1 year, 2 years ago only. And why is that? So I certainly think we have to do that. I think that we need to do finger-like studies. Finger are the studies that want to address preventable factors in the general population. And this need to be tested in Down syndrome. And Eimear and Johannes Levin in the Horizon 21 are leading initiatives to try to study those in Down syndrome. I think that we certainly need to do that. I think that certainly we need, they have a lot of advantages beyond Alzheimer's, because if you engage people with Down syndrome in activities of socializing, exercise, there has plenty of advantages. But having said that, I think that we have to follow the science, and there are two things that concern me that were very, very, there is a paper about to come out from the IBC consortium, and that it's in agreement with our data in Barcelona, that there isn't that much of a difference between in the disease onset by the level of intellectual disabilities. And of course, this is a very gross measure of engaging in activities. But someone with mild intellectual disabilities and someone with severe or profound, they have undergone completely different activities in their daily living, exercise, interaction, reading, and everything. And still we're not seeing a huge impact on the variability. The cures are very overlapping. And the other thing you said about, and this changed my view only 2 weeks ago. There was we always said, and I've said a million times in interviews, in the press and everything, that we were already impacting dementia. The age-adjusted incidence of dementia, it was decreasing in the general in the Western world. Of course, we had more dementia because of the aging population. But a 70-year-old now has less risk of dementia than a 70-year-old 30 to 50 years ago. And so that was very optimistic. We are treating hypertension. We have healthier lifestyles. However, a paper 2 weeks ago in JAMA Neurology showed that, yes, that was the case. Yes, we had less cerebrovascular component, but we did not have less AD pathology. It still could be that we can cope better with AD pathology, and it's not only cardiovascular thing. And certainly what's more important is not to take out plaques. It's take out the symptoms, what we care about. But I think we need to do that. We need to understand it's essential. I'm going to fully support any finger-like initiative. But to be honest, I think the way to go, we need to go against amyloid. We need to go against tau and inflammation. We need pharmacological interventions. I'm truly convinced we can beat that. I think that these cases, rare cases with Down syndrome and not having the APP duplication that do not develop Alzheimer's are clear a horizon for a work without dementia in this population, but we need to intervene pharmacologically. I think that we will not defeat Alzheimer's only by lifestyle intervention. You can be a Nobel Prize and get Alzheimer's. So that's very it's essential, but we have to face the harsh truth sometimes. So I'm sorry, because I 2 years ago, I was much more optimistic than I am about those.
So we have time for maybe one or two more. Anybody? Yeah.
Well, firstly, your story is absolutely incredible. I learned so much about different brains, about dementia or even asthma. It has been incredible what you're saying. But I've got a very an easy question, the hardest question in the world. Who do you look up to?
Oh, many people. For instance, one people that truly look up, and I truly mean it, for instance, residence sometimes can be hard. And I remember that when I was in my fourth year of residence, it was hard times, it was very intense. And I remember I went to UCSF, the University of California, San Francisco. And to me, that was a fantastic experience. And it was Bruce Miller, who is the leader of that group and part of GBHI here. That, for instance, is a person I really look up to. He's managed to build a team of researchers in San Francisco. Truly amazing, and I think that afterwards, all the initiatives that he's had with Ian here at Trinity with UBHI is just fantastic, and I think that he, amongst others, has been one of the people that I look up to and really admire.
Anybody up at the back of the room? I need my steps. Okay, this way. And then we might need to do a quick changeover again.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm a non-medical person, so a very lay person and a parent, right? You talk about these markers and that. At what stage, if this research that you're doing and this trials you're doing is going to be a success, at what stage do you see intervention with people with Down syndrome? Is it when they start showing it, or is it, do you expect to do it earlier on? So, I know it's probably early days for that.
No, but this is a fantastic question. I think that what the fact that disease starts 20 years before symptom onset, that gives you, we sometimes say that AD is a disease of young people that manifests in old people, but that's because it takes 20 years of pathology building up in your brain to develop pathology. So just have this idea. If I had a magical pill that did not stop 27% like lecanemab, that stopped the disease 100%, and I gave this pill to someone with dementia, that person will not continue to deteriorate, but it will still have dementia. However, if that pill I gave it in this window, you could stop the disease before the symptom onset. And this is something that is already happening. Now we have this lecanemab, the same antibody that is given, that has proven useful in people with early AD, and that's defined by mild cognitive impairment and early dementia. Now it's being given to healthy elderly that have amyloid in the brain, and that's 33% of those age 65 and older. So it's not only this scary story is not only for people with Down syndrome. 33% of in the general population, 65 and older, have amyloid in their brains. So there are trials to give these anti-amyloid therapies in cognitively healthy people to try to delay or prevent Alzheimer's. The problem with those trials is that you need to demonstrate clinical efficacy in a population that by definition has not symptoms. And you need for that very long periods of observation, of intervention, and they are underpowered. That is why we defend that people with Down syndrome are the perfect population to do it. Because in them is not a third, it's all of them by age 50 will have amyloid in their brains. And you've seen the ultra high risk and that is very scary, but it's a huge opportunity for trials. That means that it will be much easier to find an effect and prevent AD. And that is why I say that by helping people with Down syndrome might be the best way we have to treat Alzheimer's in the general population. It might be a shortcut to demonstrate the efficacy of preventive strategies in the general population. So the question is fantastic. We need to intervene before symptom onset. There's no question. Why would you wait for dementia? There's no sense.
We're going to take one more question. And then we're going to do a swift change.
My name is Christopher Bailey. I'm at WHO, and I thought your presentation was marvelous in every respect. There was one thing that you said that really resonated with me about this dichotomy between looking for a cure and looking for a way of people being productive and having a fulfilled life while living with the disease. And to me, that's a really important distinction. When I was speaking at the UN in New York at a disabilities meeting, there was a whole cadre of people with Down syndrome saying, they were advocating, they don't necessarily want a cure because that would wipe out their culture. And they define themselves by who they were. Blind people as well. I am severely visually impaired. They say, all this emphasis on a cure doesn't recognize our specialness and our life journey where we've developed other skills that are unique, ways of engaging the world which are unique and beautiful. We don't necessarily want to give that up. And so there's a tension and a complexity there in terms of the cultural aspect of having a condition that then unites you into a community of one sort or another. How, as a researcher, essentially finding some wonderful connections and potential avenues for cure, how have you navigated that cultural space?
Yeah. So I've given thought to that. And what I'm going to say, I hope, I'm expressing myself in English, I'm fluent, but this is very delicate, and maybe I'm harsher than I would like to see myself. I think one of the wonderful things of working with people with Down syndrome is that you faced intellectual disability. You learn a lot, and you learn about diversity. And I think that I fully see there are many people in the world that see Down syndrome as a disease still, and it's a condition. And people with Down syndrome teach you a lot about life, and I think it's completely aligned with what you are saying, and I fully support it in that sense. And probably the same with visual problems that you mentioned yourself. This gives you a completely different insight, if I may, into life. And that's a different perspective, a different angle. I fully respect that, and I respect that. I am not that sure about Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's, in the first place, is a disease, and I don't know if people would say the same thing about cancer. And this is a disease that is killing people. This is a deadly disease that is killing people. This is a disease, by the way, that one of the cardinal symptoms is anosognosia, which is the absolute absence or partial absence of consciousness about the disease. So there is a huge selection bias, if I may, I'm sorry to say that, in these advocates, because by definition they cannot have anosognosia, which is one of the more prevalent and pervasive symptoms of AD dementia. So it's a very special subgroup of people advocating for the whole of the population. So to me, I do see that diversity, and this is fantastic, so I truly believe in a lot of what you said, but I think Alzheimer's disease is a disease like a cancer, and I think that we should fight against Alzheimer's, and I think that most of us would like to get the Alzheimer's prevented.
And just to be clear, I was reporting on what I was hearing from the other groups. I wasn't actually stating my own opinion.
No, and it's true that even a problem, and I always say that now we're in a new era, but we are fighting nihilism. We're a lot of, I mean, there is a lot you can learn from it. You can have a positive attitude to any condition, and it's certainly a lot you can learn, and I certainly have patients and carers that truly, if you even have some care, that they suffer a lot, but there are exceptions, people that have loved the experience of care because they've learned so much, they've reconnected with the family member. So there is a lot you can learn in life from every experience, but this is a deadly disease we should fight. Thank you.
So I'd like to thank Juan Fortea. We said... I've lost my camera. We said at the start of the week that we wanted to make a safe space and a brave space. And we also said at the start of today, joy is complex. I'm going to hand over to Eimear.
Thank you so much, Dominic. We know how important physical activity is, and so we thought we would give an opportunity for everyone to have a little bit of movement. And we're really grateful and lucky today to have three physical activity leaders with us as part of a project called PPALS. So PPALS was a project that was in partnership with Age and Opportunity and Trinity, that was led by Mariana Donovan and Eilish Berkey and Trinity. This project was to enable and empower people with an intellectual disability to become physical activity leaders within their community. And so I'm delighted that we have three physical activity leaders here today who are going to lead us all in some movement. So please join in. For all the PPALS and for traveling through the snow and on a broken down Lewis to get here. So we really, really appreciate you making it here. Brain Buzzers is an online social group, and we have some members who are going to tell you a little bit about the group. So first is Megan McCormack.
Hi, everybody. So I think everybody know me from Nationwide, from Fintan Special, first thing to say. So down to the scripts. Okay. Hello, everyone. I am going to tell you about Brain Buzzers. Brain Buzzers is a club where we talk about brain health. We started about 2 years ago on Zoom. Then we could not face to face. We still meet every month on Zoom. We learn about brain and how you can keep your brain active and thinking. It's really important. We do puzzles and games like Spot the Difference and Guess the Music, as well as that we do trickshaws and quizzes, and we have a mug that says Brain Buzzers on it. I always use my mug during the meetings. We help Eimear, McGlinchey and the other researchers. With the research, we ask questions about the research and we talk about it. Eimear sent us some of her work and we discuss it and give advice and feedback. I find it interesting and it has made me think more about brain my own brain health. At the beginning, at the meetings, we get the opportunity to talk to each other and tell people our brains. I enjoy being part of Brain Bushes. It's something different.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome. I have my speech first. I have it here. Great place to put it in there. This is short and sweet, so I won't keep you too long. Now, hi, my name is Celia Aguirre, and I'm here to speak to you about brain buses today. I met a girl called Claire online, and she loved dancing and acting. So am I. On the tea break, I had American chocolates. She had Irish tea and Taylor Quips. Next page. I learned a lot. San Francisco, and you keep our brain healthy like swimming. Some people set contact with over 2 years, sent Christmas cards, their artwork, and news. Next, one of the things we did in our tea break, we made a video. And sit back, relax, and enjoy the movie. Thank you.
Part of who I am, I like to dance. I'm sure I dance moves.
I'm Melania, and I am the Ambassador Liaison Officer with the Trinity Centre for Ageing and Intellectual Disability. This year, we organised tea breaks with people from Ireland and San Francisco to talk about brain health. Some of our group will introduce themselves, share their experiences, and talk about their interests.
Hi, my name is Connor. And I had some a tea break with someone called Donald from San Francisco.
I was born and raised here in San Francisco, California.
I learned a lot about brain health, keeping active and eating a balanced diet is good for your brain health.
And what country were they from?
Ireland.
Ireland, yeah. Would you ever like to go there one day?
I'm not sure yet.
Not sure yet?
Yeah.
It's kind of far, huh?
Yeah. I don't know if I could sit down on the plane.
I thought it was amazing in the 70s.
It was, yeah, for what?
Talking to somebody the other side of the world.
We have talked about keeping our brain healthy, keep on moving, keep your heart healthy, spend time with your friends or family. Try something new for once.
Being socially active is really important for our brain health. We made some new connections to our tea breaks.
What did you think about meeting someone from another country?
Yeah, make friends that way.
Would you like to Zoom with somebody from Ireland or with Connor again? Would that be fun?
Yeah.
How come? Why would you like to do it again?
Yeah, I'd like to talk to them.
I love meeting Donald. We had a great time of chatting.
And he likes the, he likes the soccer, Star Trek, and Star Wars. And the three shooters, basketball, fear of the one dead.
It was good to meet people from another country. I enjoyed knowing what their lives were like during lockdown.
I liked the T-Rex. It was nice meeting Megan. And my family is originally from Ireland, different parts of Ireland.
Check out some examples of ways to keep our brain healthy.
I enjoy learning my piano.
How do you keep your brain healthy?
Walking, hiking, drawing, sewing, painting.
I am making fish pie to be healthy.
My favorite hobby is photography. I love photography. Say cheese, Liz.
We talked about art during our tea breaks and the importance of art in people's lives.
Good, I like to draw.
And is that good for your brain?
Yeah, and painting.
These are the other two drawings I did. From here, I just draw from down to here and stopped here, and then towards the bottom, I worked around it.
What's good for your heart is also good for your brain. Doing exercise helps to keep your heart healthy and your brain healthy.
I like to keep on moving on my new bike. I also like dancing to keep me fit at home. Roll the dog that woof 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 woof. Roll the dog that woof woof.
Skipping is really good for you and good for your heart.
So I dance moves, but the hip hop pants. Oh, I'm sorry.
We had an amazing time at our tea breaks. We made some new friends and started talking about brain health.
I'd like to thank you for those amazing tea breaks on this course. It's really great. Thank you.
I hope to see you all again soon.
Black Lives Matters represents the whole city of San Francisco. I'm proud of who I am today. I'm like Sam Jonathan today. And I'm proud to be happy. And I'm proud to be a strong mind. Just be myself. Good luck.
I'm Hazel. Okay, so Digris, at our brain buffer meetings, we sometimes write new words. Two songs that we like, we thought on what our songs, favourite songs, are. We make up new words to do with the brain and about things we like doing to keep our brains healthy. We write the songs together. It is good fun, and I appreciate it. Everyone gives ideas for the new words. Put in the song some of us like Disney. We meet on Zoom, and because of this, we do not get to sing it. Our song today, Mike, is going to sing our songs, and we want you all to join in. Please welcome Mike.
I just have news for you. Mike is not going to sing the song on his own. This is a song I wouldn't know at all. But I used to hear it on radio, and I've heard a much nicer version when I got these new words. So they're amazing. But what I would like to the more of you sing, the less of you actually look at me and realize that I can't sing it. But what I would like to teach is how to play an instrument. And I come from an era where we had amazing guitar players, and we used to... any of you play guitar?
Yeah, I used to.
Have any of you ever tried to play the air guitar? No?
Yes.
Oh, it's really easy. It's so, so easy. But you have to kind of concentrate, because there's a bit of work involved. So the air guitar, you just take a guitar like this. Yeah. And up here, you got your... This is the neck. So you got an exerciser here. And then here's the... I forget, there's part of this song has got what's called a power chord. Like, that's really, if you get the power chord, you're on tour. And the power chord, like, goes that. You know? So there's lots of opportunities of power chords in this. And, like, it really helps. We used to shake our head a lot, too, when we were kids. So we go like that. And there are definitely parts of this song where you can just become the greatest guitarist in your own head. And that's the whole point of it. And the more you concentrate on your guitar playing and your singing, the less you see me making a pure bags of it. All right? So let's have fun. Are we going to have some fun? Are we down here? We need people up here around me. Who's going to come down and join us? We've volunteers, yeah. Yeah. Come on. You said you were going to do it like air now. You got to come over here. We've got to read the words. Well, I beg your pardon. You said it to me. We watch the words here. Cool. Come on over. Come on, guys. Don't be shy. I know.
Yeah.
You're needing to pack over here. No, we're all here. Cool. Are we going to go over?
Take the happy rain over your head.
Thank you so much, Mike. As Hazel said, since we've been meeting, we have just been doing air guitar and singing on a mute. So thank you all for singing along and getting to hear our song for the first time. I'd now like to introduce our next speaker. So keeping on the trajectory of looking forward and looking on in the journey. I'm out of breath. is Professor Sean Kennelly. Professor Kennelly is the Clinical Director of the National Intellectual Disability Memory Service.
Thanks so much, but here. I don't know how you're expected to follow that. That was amazing, so it just, you know, absolutely tremendous. So on the theme of joy and I suppose what brings us joy, I think one of the things I was kind of thinking, how similar to Dr. Fortea, how do we frame this within this context? And some of it is around a challenge that's laid down and how we accomplish that challenge and the joy we receive afterwards. So what I was asked to talk a little bit about was this era that's potentially approaching of disease-modifying therapies. And I've got to say, you know, once again, thank you very much for the opportunity to talk about this. It's a very new area. It's a very, you know, quickly evolving area. And I think one of our challenges and one of the, if you like, our greatest joys may even be ahead of us. Those are just some of my disclosures. But when we look at the history of Alzheimer's disease, I think even though it's, you know, nearly 120 years ago since Alois Alzheimer's described it, really much of that progress that we've seen has happened in the last, you know, 30, 35 years or so. And, you know, back in the 70s, it was, you know, really where his work was looked at again, and we recognized that it was a disease and not merely aging. And, you know, there was that amyloid cascade hypothesis that I'll talk a little bit about in the future, that, you know, that was what was underlying this. And I would echo the sentiments that Alzheimer's disease is a, you know, while it's a condition, it is a disease, and it's a disease that I think, you know, we do need to identify early and develop treatments for. And, you know, it's in the mid-90s that we had the first drugs that were licensed. We got better at looking at MRI scans and neuroimaging and finding, you know, patterns of change that was suggestive of Alzheimer's disease. And then, you know, over the last 15, 20 years, biomarkers, both in CSF and blood, have become more common. And now we've got imaging techniques, such as the tau PETs and amyloid PETs that Dr. Fortea referred to, that are going to help with better detection. In 2021, we had the first, albeit, you know, somewhat controversially, licensed therapy for over 20 years for Alzheimer's disease and aducanumab when it was licensed by the FDA. And in 2022, I think there is probably the least and far less controversial lecanemab. But in the midst of this, in 1987, there was the identification of that amyloid precursor protein gene on chromosome 21, and as a key culprit in the causing of Alzheimer's disease. And of course, that has been talked about as one of the main risks, or one of the main factors, if not the main factor, that drives the risk for Alzheimer's disease. But we should also remember that triplicate of chromosome 21 also has other effects, both on tau, the other protein that we see in Alzheimer's disease, and, you know, in some of the functions of our brain cells and how they operate, you know, and causing some dysfunction in some of those brain cells, but also in inflammation in the brain and how our brain reacts to some of those proteins when they accumulate within it. Dr. Fortea has already mentioned this, and this is his slide, his work, and much of his work is what's referenced in this area. But actually, it is to re-echo it, the pathological sequence. So the sequence of events that happens in Down syndrome, Alzheimer's disease, is very similar to that we see in sporadic Alzheimer's disease or in other autosomal gene mutation Alzheimer's disease. But it happens earlier, and it happens at a more accelerated pace in some instances. While we talk about, you know, disease-modifying therapies, and there's a little bit to step back, and one of the things we need to step back a bit on is how we diagnose it. And up until around 2010, which isn't that long ago, this was our criteria for diagnosing Alzheimer's disease. This was our criteria for diagnosing Alzheimer's disease in most of our trials. And essentially, it was a criteria that said, is if I can't think of anything better, it might be, it probably is Alzheimer's disease. And that was essentially it. There was a few caveats along it, but that was mostly it. There was some age definitions. And what's happened in the intervening period, so between 2010 and now, in that last 13 or 14 years, the incorporation of, if you like, the clinical picture, so what it is we see as doctors, what it is we manage as doctors, the people, the symptoms that people report to us, the functional status that they have, so what we call the staging of it, and then these biomarkers, so blood tests and CSF tests, MRI scans, these other scans that we're able to use. The incorporation of both that clinical picture and these other objective measures is what is now underlying the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. So it's a far more validated diagnosis. But even within this new, if you like, paradigm of how we bring together that clinical piece and this molecular piece in how we diagnose it, it's still a complex diagnosis in people with Down syndrome. And that's because it's often, you know, difficult to establish what was clearly the baseline symptoms or the severity of intellectual disability that somebody was living with. But there's also other things. Transitions of care often happen around the time that you're trying to make a diagnosis. So people may be, you know, moving homes or moving from one house to another place of residence. I think, you know, seizures, which can often be undiagnosed and challenging to diagnose, can be happening in the context and can cause cognitive symptoms. So, you know, the symptoms we're looking at could be caused by other things, other illnesses that happen with aging and Down syndrome. Polypharmacy, certainly through the clinic, is one of those things that we see a lot of. You know, so where people are commenced on medicines that actually could be contributing to their cognitive symptoms and decline. Life events, you know, that can happen, that can cause changes in mood, changes in behavior. And then, you know, one of the things that we regularly refer to is poorly managed pain. So where people maybe have difficulty articulating pain, things like constipation. So simple things can actually preempt. So as challenging as it is, I think the challenge of diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease within, you know, with people with Down syndrome goes both ways. And sometimes I think it's overdiagnosed and sometimes it's underdiagnosed. And it's not that, you know, the timeliness is what's key and the accuracy is what's key. This would be, you know, very much something that I know Professor McCarron would echo, is we really need to establish a national brain check program whereby we complete a baseline cognitive functional assessment for people at, you know, at least the age of 35 in all people with Down syndrome. And that would really greatly aid our ability to detect accurately in a timely fashion detect Alzheimer's disease. But it also gives us an opportunity to look at some of those other health issues that can contribute to this, like obstructive sleep apnea, breathing disorders, you know, thyroid disorders, you know, which can contribute, and even looking and looking at epilepsy. So it's not just around a timely opportunity to see where people are at, see if there's things we can contribute, but we know there are other medical things we can identify that will lead to a more healthy aging. I'm going to come back to the brain health piece, which was mentioned earlier on. And I echo your sentiments with regards where we're at. I think it's a very important thing that we maintain a focus on. I think there is lots of other reasons as to why we need to do it. I think there's lots of other psychological and medical and clinical reasons why we need to pursue a healthy brain health piece. I don't know that, you know, this is Jill Livingston's piece from The Lancet. I don't know that the same benefits will automatically translate, but I think it's a really, really important piece to do, and hearing and vision, exercise, diet, social connectivity are all very important factors that we need to encourage. And I suppose there's some encouragement from this, and this is from Andre Striden's group over in London recently, where they looked at physical activity and cognitive changes. And this wasn't a randomized controlled study like the ones I'm going to talk about in a little bit, but it did emphasize that people with higher and better levels of physical activity who didn't have any, who didn't have dementia, who 2 years, 2 years later when they looked at them and they reviewed them, there was less evidence of decline in their memory. So there is almost certainly some transference of a brain health piece towards a cognitive protective piece. And I think in particular exercise is a really important thing. But I completely agree, we need to understand a little bit more to validate what exactly a brain health program looks like for people who are living with, who have Down syndrome, and how we optimize it and actually support people engaging with it. Giving a platform is so much more important than the discussion as to whether or not it works. I said I'd come back to the amyloid cascade hypothesis because when we talk about disease-modifying therapies, it's important. So amyloid and tau are those two proteins we know accumulate in the brain and are most likely to cause the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease. Our current treatments, which are the cholinesterase inhibitors and memantine and things like that for Alzheimer's disease, are mostly symptomatic, and they really engage at that lower level down that cascade. So after a lot of the work, you know, if you like, a lot of the impact on brain cells has already happened by the time we're giving them, and they're mostly symptomatic, and they sustain, and they get the best out of the brain cells that are still working. Disease modification happens much earlier. So if you like, we're going right up that cascade to an earlier stage, and we're looking at trying to remove those proteins that cause the damage later on. And that's the difference between, if you like, a treatment and a disease-modifying treatment. And how do we measure that they work? Well, we look at those biomarkers that Dr. Fortea mentioned earlier on. The most important one is always going to be how we, talking to, families and people living with the condition and asking them, how is their cognitive performance and where's their functional status? So we use measures of that in a trial. We look at imaging through MRI scans and through PET scans. And we look at blood tests and CSF biomarkers at those protein levels and see if we've shifted those proteins from the brain. So that's how we make a judgment as to whether or not we've achieved disease modification over time. When we talk about then clinical trials, so how do we establish a treatment has worked? How do we establish that it has worked? Well, it can take 10 years from somebody having an idea that a medicine or molecule might impact on the effect of a condition to getting it into, if establishing that it's safe, establishing that it works, and then getting it to somebody. The most important trials, so we have phase one trials where we're kind of just testing and making sure that, it's safe, and then we're looking at in phase two trials, we're trying to see, make sure it's safe and see what dose works. And in phase three trials is where we take that dose that we established in the phase two trial and we say, right, we're going to have a look and see how it works. And in a phase three trial, the key things is randomized. So in other words, people are going to get, the treatment, or they're going to get a dummy treatment. And they won't know which is which, because actually it's a double blind. So the doctor or the person who's treating, and even the, most people won't know who's getting which treatment until the very end when they look at it. And there's very clear goals that you say, this is how we know this treatment will have worked, and this is be how we know it didn't work. So there's very clear what we call endpoints for your study. So that's how we establish that these medicines work. And if we look at Alzheimer's disease in general, and this is from Jeff Cummings, and they do this every year, there is huge grounds to be optimistic. There is an awful lot of treatments. So that phase three stage, which is a very advanced stage whereby we're looking to see if treatments work, and there's over 30 treatments that are being reviewed in phase three trials for Alzheimer's disease, and the majority of those is looking at disease modification. So in other words, it's looking at how we interfere with the course and the progression of the disease and potentially, hopefully, preventing Alzheimer's disease dementia. There's only, though, when we look at, and I was just looking yesterday evening at clinicaltrials.gov, though, when we look at, people with Down syndrome AD, there is only one clinical trial, phase three, currently. And this is the challenge. This is what we need to address. This is, what is very important, and this is what Dr. Fortea was alluding to. When we look at the compound, the medicines that have been, touted as disease modifying. There's really kind of four that are kind of key at the minute. Aducanumab, I'm not going to talk an awful lot about, even though that was the first one that came out a year or two ago. It's been licensed in the US. There really hasn't been a huge amount of uptake, and depending on who you talk to, it was either the first disease modifying therapy for Alzheimer's disease or the worst decision the FDA ever made. And to be honest, the truth is probably somewhere in between. I think lecanemab and how it's progressed is probably going to have aducanumab, less relevant in this area as we go on. Donanemab is worth mentioning because I think the results of a large phase three trial are due out later on this year, and there has been interesting results from earlier stage trials on it. Gantenerumab was a successful trial, negative result of a compound that was yet again at the end of 2022. And lecanemab is the one, I suppose, that Dr. Fortea mentioned for which there is great hope. The reason why I put them all up, though, wasn't actually just to go through the shopping list of the potential different drugs, but also to highlight amyloid exists in different forms within the brain. So when we talk about disease modification and we talk about amyloid therapies, we can't think of them as a singular entity. Some of them target the clumps, the plaques. Some of them target soluble amyloid. Some of them target the species that are in between, which are called protofibrils. And that fibrillar form is considered probably the most toxic form. So that's why it's important to know that there isn't a one-size-fits-all when it comes to amyloid therapies. They target different forms of protein. Lecanemab is the compound that was talked about that just before Christmas they released their paper in the New England Journal. And the most reassuring thing about it was the consistency of the data. And we'll talk a little bit about what defines a large data. But what we saw was there was a 27% decline in the rate of cognitive decline. So there was an impact on how it removed amyloid by the brain, demonstrated by the amyloid by the PET scans. And then functioning was better in people who received the drug. Memory scores were better in people who received the medicine. So right across a suite, including quality of life indicators. And remember, these are blinded, so people don't know whether they're getting medicine or whether they're getting the placebo. And right across all of those measures, there was a consistent signal. It was over 18 months, and it is an infusion that's given every 2 weeks. So not an easy therapy to take. Donanemab is that other medicine I mentioned, and just in the interest of time, it's really that the earlier results of it have been very promising, and we'll have more definitive results later on in the year, but it's probably one to watch as well. I suppose the key things about these medicines then is, okay, well, if we have a medicine that maybe targets these proteins, takes them out of the brain, well, are they going to be safe? And what is the safety tolerability? And what we know that one to two people out of 20 on the study had to stop due to new symptoms. So they were relatively tolerable. It was usually the type of stuff that you'd get in many trials. There was these infusion-related reactions, which is when you give a medicine, especially and a medicine that works on the immune system, you can get these cold chills, headaches, and you can kind of feel a little bit flu-y after it. And they occurred in one in three people, usually after the first dose and usually not after. And then there's the whole issue about people who are on blood thinners. And oftentimes we'd have people on blood thinners in particular to reduce the risk of stroke. And there has been some incidences where there has been brain bleeds that happened in people who have blood thinners. The main side effects, I suppose, with these medicines are these things called ARIA. And these are related to how when we shift amyloid out of the brain, some of that amyloid is probably in blood vessels. And as a result, we get a little bit of leakage, sometimes of fluids, which leads to what we call ARIA-E, which is little swellings in the brain. And then ARIA-H is where when we take the amyloid out, those blood vessels get leaky and we get little bleeds, so what we call microhemorrhages in the brain. Now, most of these are asymptomatic. Most of them resolve over the space of a few months. But in some occasions, in small numbers, they can cause headaches. And there are some people who have to stop the therapies when they have them. A key thing is exactly as Dr. Fortea said, these ARIAs may turn out to be more common in people who have Down syndrome, in that we know that there is that amyloid in the blood vessel is a bit more common. That cerebral amyloid angiopathy is a bit more common. So we will need to proceed with caution, when it is that we're looking at applying these new treatments, hopefully. So then comes to the question, okay, because this is what every doctor, when they sit across the desk with somebody who's saying, will we, take a treatment or won't we take a treatment? This is what it is the benefit good enough? Is the risk too great? And that is it for most medicines, and these medicines will be no different. And much of it will have to be through individual conversations. We'll have a better idea. So the whole thing about, is the therapeutic effect good enough? Well, to be honest, we need to look at longer. And what we're seeing so far is very, very promising. It was conclusive enough to get a license to start looking at these in clinical practice. But ultimately, the people who come and see us and talk to us in clinic, their main concern is around remaining at home, remaining independent. And for us to see the effects on that, in particular in people with mild memory symptoms, you need to be really following for at least 7-8 years. So I think we're going to see whether or not these marginal gains that we're seeing at the beginning, if they're amplified downstream, which is what we would expect if the model is correct. I think the other thing to consider, and it does come back to the issue of brain health and why I think brain health is also still important, is amyloid is definitely the key pathology for people with Down syndrome. But when we solve that problem, well, there is the other potential that we have to deal with the other pathologies as they may accumulate. So the risks for vascular disease, alpha-synuclein that we see with Lewy body disease, TDP-43 that we see with other dementias, and tau that causes other dementias, well, actually, they may become. So when we solve it, there may also be a need to make sure that we have a healthy brain to support strategies for other pathologies. And there's already new trials going on that's looking at combination of amyloid and tau therapies, immunotherapies, to reduce the risk of Alzheimer's disease. So that's why we see modest effects, because if we're just taking out one of those, you know, most people who have Alzheimer's disease will have some of these other pathologies. If we just take out one, well, we've probably taken out the main one. We'll get probably a good step change, but it's not the definitive piece. So we won't be able to stop with amyloid therapies. There will be a need for us to push on to find therapeutic answers. And looking at neuroinflammation and things like that is very important. We don't know about the efficacy specifically in people who have, you know, Down syndrome and these and other gene mutations. We'll have to see. And we don't know the risks specifically in this population. So these are things that we will have to establish in what we call phase four studies, hopefully, whereby we look at post, you know, when we've given these medicines and we look over a longer period of time, and hopefully we get to give these therapies to people, in those brackets, that we're able to sort of see that those risks match up to the general population. But the implications are is that we're going to have to look at a system that's able to be able to give infusions, a system that's able to be able to do amyloid PET scans, MRI scans to monitor. So it's actually, you know, the future, in some respects, for how we treat Alzheimer's disease will look for a period of time as it does for how we treat cancer. It is a chemotherapy era, in some respects. That always has to be balanced out, but how we support people to live well, how we actually focus on ensuring that people who don't get therapies or aren't eligible for therapy still get the full benefits of holistic care pathway, and how we support people who aren't necessarily going to be eligible for these therapies. But for people who are eligible for these therapies, there is that potential that we may be able to prevent dementia. So I propose, and I've kind of put 7 years. I did, Dr. Fortea, I mentioned five. I think it's kind of, I hope, quickest. But I would hopefully see an era over the next few years whereby we will be doing routine brain checks on people by 35 that will lead us to a better timely diagnosis. A blood test will identify whether or not there is Alzheimer's disease pathology. People will come forward, they'll have their MR scans, and they'll have their investigations. So it'll be timely identification. There'll be risk-benefit analysis. We'll be able to look and see what's on MRI scans that will probably help us risk stratify who might be at greater risk. And we know certain genes like APOE will also confer a different risk. We'll confirm that there's Alzheimer's disease. We'll confirm that there's amyloid there. We'll initiate treatment. And then, you know, after doing that, we'll be able to support people to live well. And, you know, it's cure is a very difficult word to manage. And it was, you know, but treat is a much easier word to manage. And I think as we do for many things, we should be able to hopefully be entering a new era where we can definitively treat Alzheimer's disease and prevent dementia, as we do with many conditions. I don't have a cure for blood pressure, but I have lots of treatments that manage it. And I think that's similar to how, you know, hopefully the future era for people with Down syndrome. It's going to take a massive effort, and you know, just to highlight some of the groups, you know, around the world that we're linking in with and trying to establish trial-ready cohorts to look at some of these studies. Dementia Trials Ireland, with Professor Leroy as the lead on it, and within an Irish context, has Down syndrome as one of its key populations that we want to develop strategies for get participation in phase three studies for. And Maylin had the first word at the start of the day, and I'm going to give her the last word at the end of my presentation, because really there's nothing that I can say that, you know, will say it any more elegantly than the people who are demanding their therapies. And Maylin has been an incredible ambassador for the memory service and for TCAID over the last while. So thank you.
So we're not going to take questions, partly in the interest of time, but after this session, we have in here a living lab, and the living lab looks at neuroscience and so forth. Sean, thank you hugely. Thank you again.
Thank you so much, Sean. I'd now like to introduce Professor Mary McCarron. So Mary has really paved the way for so much dementia research here in Ireland and is still making new pathways. So Mary's going to reflect on some of her work and some of the changes she's seen.
Thank you, everyone. And it's a great pleasure to be here, and indeed a great joy to be here. And I look over at my colleague, Professor Brian Lawler here, and I started working with Brian. I'm going to give our ages away, Brian, by saying probably in 1994. It's a long time. And my background was intellectual disability nursing. That's what I started off as. And I met at that time people with Down syndrome and people with other forms of intellectual disability that were aging in poor health. And no one seemed to know what was wrong. And I often asked if anyone really cared. And I wasn't sure that people really did. And I came at that time to work here on the first genetic study with Mary Cosgrove and Jeanette Turl and people like that, looking at genetic risk factors for Down syndrome. And that is back in 1995. So it has taken a long time to get to here. But today, not only are we have we heard of all of this fantastic work that is happening, but now we are seeing people with Down syndrome, many are here today, telling us that we need to do this, supporting us in our work. People with Down syndrome are now working with us as researchers, as colleagues in our workplace, and Maylene has been working with me for the past few years. So this is how things have really moved. So it really does give me fantastic hope to see, you know, to hear and the like of Dr. Fortea, and now we have Dr. Eimear McGlinchey, Global Brain Health Fellows, the next generation of people coming through to really drive on this agenda. And I have really great hope that people, we will find certainly, hopefully cures, and if not, really good treatments for dementia in people with Down syndrome. And as my colleague, Professor Sean Kennelly, has said, you know, cure does not equate to no treatment, and it does not equate to no hope. And there is lots of reasons to have hope. And I am so pleased now, I suppose when I started my career, I came here probably as nearly a lone researcher, a lone person to this great establishment of Trinity College. And, you know, I thought, what would we need to do to move the dial and to move the wheel? And at that time, shortly after I came and did my own PhD, Ireland was launching the first longitudinal study in ageing, led by Professor Roseanne Kenny, general ageing. And as I looked at the map of the world, I quickly realised that not one country in the world had ever included people with an intellectual disability in tandem with a general longitudinal study in ageing. And people told me at that time, Mary, you're crazy, it couldn't happen. Protocol would be way too difficult. People won't be able to participate. You won't get ethical approval. There was all of the negatives. Today, we're out in the field 15 years later. There is over 30 researchers out in the field collecting data. And we have had almost a 90% retention rate over that time. So people with intellectual disability wanted to be part of research. They have encouraged us to be part of research. And it really gives me great hope as I see, you know, I'm at the other end of my career and I see the next generation. I see people like Dr. Aoife McFeely, who we have, you know, got into this groove. We have Professor Sean Kennelly, who now lead this. I see Roisin here today as well, Roisin Vaughan, who's here, who's working with us. And people like Eimear. The biggest tragedy for me would be that we didn't have the next generation to keep all of this going. And we have that, and that's a great sense of hope. And we have galvanised the community. That is the academics, the researchers, the families, the communities, and people with intellectual disability themselves. And together we can make great strides and we can bring great hope. So I think today, and it's a really apt title for this seminar today or this event, and that is bringing joy, because I think there is lots to be joyful about and there is great hope for the future. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Mary. As we're coming towards the end of the session, we're going to have a summary of some of the talks we had today. So first, I'd like to welcome Ross O'Neill, who's going to summarise some of the main points that Dr. Juan Fortea said. Thank you so much, Ross.
Thank you. Now, before I get started on this, I'm going to say two things. I'm also here to represent people with disabilities and Down syndrome, because I work for the National Office in Down syndrome Ireland. So I'm going to get into it now. People with Down syndrome are living to old age. When people with Down syndrome get dementia, the things that happen in the blood and in the brain are the same as for people without Down syndrome. There are things that we can measure in the blood that help kind of someone who's getting dementia. There are groups of people in America and in Europe working to try to stop dementia. In people with Down syndrome, dementia might be easier to cure in people with Down syndrome than in other people. We have to keep doing the research with Down syndrome. So thank you very much.
Claire
Murphy, who's going to summarise Sean's speech. Hi, I'm Claire Murphy. The main things that Sean said, we know much more about dementia than we used to at the minute. If people get dementia, we give them medicine, but there might be new medicines coming out soon. Before we can give people the new medicines, we have to check that they are safe. Scientists have done some work already to check these medicines and to see if they might help with dementia. But we have to make sure they will work for people with Down syndrome too. This type of research is called clinical trials. This means that we have to make sure that people with Down syndrome are included in clinical trials too. Even though these medicines won't come for a while, there are things that we can do now to help people to stay healthy. People with Down syndrome should be able to get checkups for their brain when they are 25. And we can tell people about things that they can do in their lifestyle that help them to keep their brain healthy, for example, a balanced diet or exercise. The most important thing that
people with Down syndrome are included on this journey.
I'd like to invite everybody involved in this morning's presentation. Would you like to come to the stage? Everybody, come up. Eimear. It's a team effort. Mikey. Sean, Juan, Mary. Yeah, and while you're assembling,
my name is Maria McGuire, and I'm fascinated listening to all of these this morning. I have a particular interest in Alzheimer's because I have a couple of family members who have it. But the wonderful thing I think here is that people with Down syndrome are being recognised as people, that they're not just a section on their own and sure it doesn't matter. They're now being looked at as people, and they deserve the same attention as anybody else who might have it. I'm going to borrow a phrase from a well-known politician. A lot done, a lot more to be done. Thank you all so much for all the work you're doing.
So a huge thanks from Creative Brain Week to everybody involved in this morning session. And as you can hear in the background, people are warming up, people are getting ready to play, but I want to give the last word over.
We are making history.